Now we can proceed with the program. We have five contributed presentations. Each one is supposed to be 15 minutes, so I will ask the speakers to stay rigidly on time. I will give you, you a warning, 3 minutes before you start, you finished. The first presentation is given by Marta Alberto. Where are you? Okay. And the contribution is contribution of quantum mechanical computations to the elucidation of a catalytic mechanism of binuclear metallohydrolysis.
Well, first of all, I want to thank the organizing for giving me this opportunity to talk about my work today. And today I want to show you some results concerning the quantum chemical modeling of the catalytic mechanisms of binuclear metallohydrolysis, and in particular focusing our attention on the case of serine threonine phosphatase. Before starting, just to introduce myself, I've been working at the University of Calabria for 6 years. And my main research field deals with bioinorganic chemistry, and in particular with the reaction mechanisms of metallic anti-cancer drugs, and also reaction mechanisms of metalloenzymes, also including biomimetic enzymes. But I'm also interested in inorganic homogeneous catalysis, and so the activation of strong bond and hydrogen storage and production. And I'm also involved in project devoted to the prediction of photophysical properties of new compounds to be used in photodynamic therapy and as materials for electrochromism. Well, what about binuclear metallohydrolysis? This large family of enzymes require two metal ions in the active site to carry out a plethora of hydrolytic reactions. And since they are involved in several vital reaction, it's not surprising that they are potential targets of drugs against a wide variety of human disorders, including osteoporosis and various kinds of cancer. And they also tend to be promiscuous, so they catalyze more than one reaction. And this promiscuous nature may in part explain why binuclear metallohydrolysis have evolved in recent times to deal with situations created by man. Let's think about organophosphate pesticides that appeared only 70 years ago. Well, among them, there are some representatives that we have already investigated. For example, purple acid phosphatases that are the only member of this family that carry out the hydrolysis of monophosphate by using a heterovalent active site, so iron 3 combined with a divalent metal ions. And serine threonine phosphatase, that is the topic of my talk, and organophosphate degrading enzyme that catalyzed the hydrolysis of diphosphate, and also prolidase that catalyzed the hydrolysis of peptide in which is present a proline. And of course, there are other members such as ureasis, alkaline phosphatase, leucine, aminopeptidase, and so on. They are believed to share a common reaction mechanism, even if the identity of the nucleophile and the identity of the dimethyl cluster is different. How is it possible to study this kind of reaction mechanism? Well, actually, we use the so-called cluster approach that gives us the opportunity to investigate in detail the reaction mechanism just considering a limited part of the enzyme, and so the active site. Well, generally, the model starts from an X-ray structure, even if it's not an absolute requirement. I mean, it's possible that we have a lot of experimental indication that allow us to construct the model, even if we don't have the X-ray structure. Well, the enzyme's active site and some other important residues, if necessary, are included in the cluster model, and only the side chains of the residues are kept in the model. And we also take into account the effect of the rest of the enzyme that is not explicitly included in our cluster model by using a continuum model. Well, of course, it's not a priori obvious that this kind of model works. But one of the physical justifications is that the energies involved in chemical reaction, and so bond breaking and formation, are usually much higher than long-range electrostatic. And moreover, in the case of metalloenzymes, this kind of approach has proven to be very useful, since all the important chemical steps take place at the metal ions, and the metal ions help keeping the different residues together in such a rigid structure. An example illustrating how the increase of the system size does not dramatically change the thermodynamics and kinetics of the reaction has been shown in a recent paper of Maria Ramos and Pedro Fernandez, in which they calculated the activation energy and the reaction rate considering three different models. One small model, a big cluster model containing 140 atoms, and finally a very large model. And they show that the results obtained with a big cluster model containing 140 atoms is very, very similar to the results obtained with the onium calculation. Moreover, they also, I want to underline that in the case of the cluster model, the results obtained in gas phase are almost equal to the results obtained with the dielectric constant equal 4. And so this indicates that when a large cluster model is used, the effect of the surrounding protein are already included in the quantum calculation. And, Well, serine threonine phosphatase catalyzed the hydrolysis of phosphoserine and phosphothreonine residues. And this enzyme is very important since the phosphorylation and the phosphorylation of protein are crucial biological events. And experimentally, it has been shown that this enzyme contains mostly manganese, a D-manganese cluster, even if also iron and zinc has been determining in the structure. And we chose to study the D-manganese containing PP5 derivative. Well, we started from the PDB code, so from the X-ray structure, in which we found two manganese, the first one coordinated to two histidine and an asparagine, the second manganese coordinated to an histidine, an aspartate, and a water molecule, and both the metals are coordinated to the potential nucleophile and an aspartate. Well, since the X-ray structure has been determined in the presence of an inhibitor and not in the presence of the substrate, we modeled the substrate in the cavity as phosphoserine. And we also decided to include some other residues of the second coordination shell, so an arginine, an aspartate, another arginine, and an histidine 204, since they are suggested to be involved in the catalytic mechanism. The resulting cluster is of 128 atoms. Well, while the location of the potential nucleophile is clearly indicated in the X-ray structure, the protonation state of it and of the water molecule in the active site is open to discuss. So we decided to investigate three different models, having different charge, of course, considering two hydroxide, one hydroxide and one water molecule, and two water molecules. This kind of exploration is very important since the activation energy of enzymes that catalyze, in particular, this kind of reaction is very sensitive to the charge balance around the active center. These are the computational details we have used in our investigation. DFT level and the hybrid BFRLib functional, and also we perform single point calculation with larger basis set, also testing the another functional, a meta-hybrid MPWB1K, and of course we considered also the solvent effect. The proposed mechanism in literature is an inline approach of the nucleophile and the departure of the living group, but we don't have indication on the mechanism if it proceeds by an SN2-like mechanism, SN1 mechanism, and so on. Something similar has been found in our previous work on parpolecid phosphatase, in which we found a transition state for the nucleophilic attack and the second transition state for the release of the living group. Also, in the case of prolidase, we found a transition state just for the nucleophilic attack and another transition state for the protonation of the living group. In the case of serine threonine phosphatase, the first step of our investigation was to stabilize, to determine the most stable spin multiplicity of the system, taking into account that an antiferromagnetic coupled binuclear center has been found for many D-manganese enzymes. So we're taking into account this kind of coupling between our metals. And actually, we found that the spin multiplicity 1 that arises from a high spin configuration of both manganese antiferromagnetically coupled is the most stable one. And even if the difference between the spin multiplicity 1 and 11 is very small in the case of enzyme substrate complex, if we reproduce the energetic of the process, we can see that the difference is very big between considering the antiferromagnetic coupling or not. So this kind of exploration is usually disregarded in the theoretical calculation of enzymatic reaction. Let's start with the charge zero model that arises from considering two hydroxide, and we found for this model this kind of process. So just one transition state in which we observe the nucleophilic attack, the departure of the living group protonated by the histidine 304 to give the product. This is the energetic profile obtained with the two functionals, and both give results in agreement with the experimental indication of the turnover rate of the enzyme. In the case of charge 1 model, we found two transition states for the reaction to occur. But if we look at the first transition state, we can see that it's not so different with respect to the other. I mean, there is always the nucleophilic attack and the departure of the living group, but the real difference is that the living group departs without any protonation. And so in the second transition state, we observe the protonation of the living group. This is the energetic profile for this charge 1 model. And of course, you can see that the energy of the first transition state is very high. And of course, it's not compatible with the typical experimental rate of phosphatase. I reported here the picture of the vibrational mode for the first transition state in the charge 0 model and the first transition state for the charge 1 model, in which it's clear the protonation of the living group in the first case and the release of the living group without any protonation in the second transition state. And these two transition states differ in energy about 7-10 kilokmol. This means that the activation of the living group by the protonated histidine 304 is decisive to reach an optimal catalytic efficiency. Analogies with PAP, with our previous investigation. Also in that case, we were able to locate two transition states. So I concerted the transition state in which we observed the release of the living group protonated, and another transition state in which the living group is protonated before leaving. And also in this case, we found a big difference in the energetic of these two transition states. Well, just to conclude, I want to show you the role of the catalytic residues. First of all, this is the superposition between our enzyme substrate complex and the X-ray structure. And so the role of the two arginines together with the manganese ions is to counterbalance the phosphate's negative charge. Moreover, the arginine 275 protonate the hydroxide coordinated to the second manganese. In this way, the enzyme's active site achieves a better charge distribution. And histidine 204 and aspartate act together to stabilize the leaving group. And the same role, of course, are in the transition state and in the product. Okay, the conclusion. The reaction proceeds through an inline concerted transition state with an energy of 15.8 and no intermediates, corroborating also the experimental studies in which no phosphoenzyme intermediate has been determined. The important role played by histidine 204 and aspartate as stabilizer of the leaving group has been shown, while the role of the metal seems to be mostly electrostatic. And we have also shown the importance of properly describing the electronic configuration of the manganese-manganese binuclear cluster. And of course, the activation energy is very sensitive to the surrounding charge. I forgot to say you that the model with two water molecules, of course, have shown a very high energy for the first transition state. So I didn't show you the result concerning that model. More information can be found in our just accepted work published on chemistry. And I want to thank my supervisor, Nino Russo, and José Ribeiro from the University of Porto, and Maria João Ramos. And of course, thank you for your attention.
And for perfect timing, we have time for one question or two quick questions. Somebody else? Yeah, please. One quick question.
Actually, it's just a comment. It's very nice, and it's really good that you you showed that the antiferromagnetic coupling between the manganese must be taken into account, and that's something which shows up in many situations with open shell transition metals, the first row transition metals, in the solid state. I'll talk about that a little bit later today. That antiferromagnetic coupling is critical to take into account, and so it's great that you did that.
Thank you. So, quick.
One quick curiosity. You mentioned the concerted versus the sequential mechanism there, and you found that the sequential is actually the more energetically favored. Is there anything about the time scale that will require to do the concerted action? Because, of course, it's more energetic, but it seems to be a faster process. Am I mistaken?
Oh, it's a faster process, but the real difference is the protonation of the leaving group. It's not a concerted mechanism. Since even in the charge one model, we found a concerted mechanism in some extent. Actually, we found always the nucleophilic attack and the release of the leaving group at the same time, always concerted mechanism. The real difference is the protonation of the leaving group. This is the energetic difference.
Okay, thank you very much.